Good morning.
Good morning.
It's nice to see you again. These strange times in which we are living, how unusual. It's been especially strange for my wife and I. We just moved on Friday. We moved to the Western home in Cedar Falls. And this morning, I could not find my shoes. So I thought, I could go in sandals. That's kind of biblical, right? And probably standing behind the pulpit, nobody would notice anyway. I did find them in among many boxes still in the garage. You know how that process goes. It's been interesting these last few months as I've had the chance to lead in worship at various congregations, and every church is doing it kind of differently, which is kind of fun. I was at Titanca several weeks ago, one of our Reformed churches, way far away, if you know where Titanca is, and it's a church way out in the country. And they're having a drive-in service. So in their parking lot, they probably had 30 cars that pulled in. And the preacher was supposed to stand. They had a scaffolding that about 8 feet high with a ladder next to it. And the idea was that I was supposed to preach from the top of this scaffolding. It was incredibly windy that day. So they relented and let me come down a little closer to the ground, for which I was grateful. But isn't it good that even though we're having to do things in different ways, the essentials haven't changed. The desire we have for community, the desire to have corporate worship, to be together and to worship God stays the same. And I really appreciate the hard work and creativity that has gone into the planning in so many congregations, including your own. We're here to witness to our faith in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. When John was beginning to write, remember he said, that which was from the beginning, which we've heard, which we've seen with our eyes, which we've looked upon and touched with our hands concerning the word of life, that life was made manifest, and we saw it and testified to it and proclaimed to you that eternal life that was with the Father and His Son, Jesus Christ. That which we have heard and seen, we proclaim also to you so that you may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. It is in His name that we meet together to pray today. I know that you're a congregation in mourning as you're grieving Kenny's death, and we sure want to continue to pray for and support Kenny's family during this time of loss and grief. Watching the news a little bit this morning, hearing about the devastation in areas like Cedar Rapids, is, you know, so much damage to homes and to families and to crops. It's just, it's pretty amazing. As if, you know, on top of everything else, dealing with the pandemic and the issues that are raised by that, it's a very difficult time. And I'm hoping that today as we look to the Word of God, that maybe we can find some answers and some encouragement during this difficult time. So I'm going to lead us in prayer as we begin our time of worship. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, you know all things. The Bible tells us, you know the words we're going to say before they're even on our tongue. You know everything that's going on in this whole world. The pandemic did not catch you by surprise. The storms that devastated, you know, so much of our state did not come as a surprise to you. As we deal with injury and suffering and death, you are there with us, and we're grateful for that. So I thank you that we are together, a body in Jesus Christ. Thank you for these friends who have come together to worship you today. I pray that as we turn to your word, we would find encouragement and comfort as we're taught and directed by your Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Our hymn is number, is 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. I think the words are here on the screen, is that right? So we'll stand as we continue worshiping together.
So sweet to trust in Jesus.
One of the sacrifices we're making during this time is our greeting of one another. And I remember last times I was here, you guys spend way too much time talking to each other during the greeting time. So we're not going to encourage that kind of fellowship this morning, but I understand you can look back at the camera and wave and greet folks who are not here today. So I want you to take just a moment to do that, and you can wave to one another and kind of yell across the pews for just a moment as well. All right, we're going to continue with you may be seated, excuse me. Yeah, sure. Our special music today, we have special guests with us, Zach Williams and Dolly Parton. And this is a part of our worship as we give attention to the words of this song.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand, start to fall, and all those lonely roads that I've traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. Well, there was Jesus. In the way, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in broken pieces.
Good, wasn't it? My wife and I were just recently, I was watching carefully because my wife and I were just recently in a commercial, filmed for a commercial. I have some friends who have kind of a business doing that, and they signed a contract with a big company that makes stadium lighting. And so they were making some commercials for them. And so they wanted, one shot was going to be grandma and grandpa looking online at their granddaughter playing softball. And so it would show the team playing softball, and then it would switch to the grandma and grandpa watching them. So I said, well, like, how much will we be on? He said, about 8 seconds, he said. And so we spent 45 minutes filming this 8 seconds of us. Okay, now let's try a close-up. Now let's try, you know, so. Well, I think about a video like that. My goodness, a lot of work went into that, I am sure. I want to just remind ourselves of the power and the importance of the Word of God. So we're going to be looking at 1 Samuel chapter 1 today. If you have a Bible with you and want to turn to that, that's pretty much what we're going to be looking at and focus on. So I want to lead us in prayer as we come to God's Word. Lord, we recognize that we would be lost without your word. Thank you for those sort of two miraculous things that you did. One was inspiring the writing of this book so that we would have a standard, a rule, a source of knowledge that we need so desperately. And then thank you for preserving it. I mean, here we are. It's been, you know, basically 2,000 years since the writing of this book ended, and yet we have these amazingly accurate accountings of what you've been doing in the world. So, Holy Spirit, be our teacher, not just now, but every day as we turn to your word. Inspire us and encourage us and help us, teach us through the power of the Bible. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. I was thinking recently, a few years ago, it's been quite a few years ago now, Orchard Hill was going to put online some sort of little biographical information about each person on the staff. And so we had some questions that we had to answer, you know, like where were you born and what's your hobby? And so for what's your hobby, I said my hobby was Renaissance architecture. I don't even know what that is. I just was feeling silly that day, I guess. So for some time after that, there online was Pastor Ed Baker, hobby, Renaissance architecture. And I had people asking me about that. I don't know what that is even. If I actually were to say what my hobby is, I would probably say it's reading. I love a good story. And I think that's one of the reasons that I really love the Bible. Because it has sort of both of these things. You know, it's this amazing account of how God has been working in the world. And it's the means by which we know God and through which we come into a relationship with Him. So that part of it. But the Bible is also a darn good story, isn't it? You know, it's just really interesting stories and accounts and people in the Bible that I enjoy so much. And I think that's one of the reasons. For me, I almost come at it both ways. You know, sometimes I'm reading it because I want to learn and because I have some questions. And sometimes this is because I just want to enjoy this account of how God's been working at the world. So it's amazing how God has used people like us to accomplish really amazing things. And we're going to be looking at one of those people today from the Old Testament. And so I think maybe we need to get a little context for that, because the Old Testament especially is, it's big and it's kind of confusing. So let's see if we can kind of get an overview of this today. So there are really two dates. Now this maybe will be helpful to you. There are sort of two dates from the Old Testament. If you can keep these straight, it helps you to kind of keep the events of the Old Testament line. One would be Abraham. And the other would be the date for David, King David. So Abraham lived at 2000 BC, And David lived at 1000 BC. Those are easy dates, right? So then you can kind of place other events around those. So we got Abraham at when? 2000 BC, and David at? Yeah, so we're going back pretty much to the time of Abraham, 2000 BC. God begins this work of redemption for humanity that's going to culminate in the coming of Jesus Christ. God calls Abraham. He leaves his home in Ur of the Chaldees. He goes to this land, the land of Palestine and Canaan, that God has promised to him and his descendants. They're there for a few generations. Then because of a famine in the land, they go to Egypt. There, they're growing as a nation and as a people, and they are enslaved by the Egyptians. They're led out of slavery by Moses and then by Aaron. And eventually they come back to where it sort of started with Abraham, back to this promised land. But when they get there, it's almost like they're not a nation exactly. It's more like they are sort of these 12 kind of individual tribes. They don't have a king yet because the first kings are Saul, David, and Solomon. And we know when David lived, right? 1000 BC, yeah. So before that time, they were just kind of this loose sort of gathering of tribes, the 12 tribes. And when there was a need, God would raise up a leader that we call the judges. And these men and women would sort of lead Israel for a period of time. And then when the crisis passed, then they would kind of go back to sort of being leaderless. And they didn't have the temple yet. They didn't have a capital city in Jerusalem. David is the one who established Jerusalem as the capital city. And we know when he lived, 1000 BC, right? And his son Solomon builds the temple. So they've still got this tent church, the tabernacle, that they'd carried with them in the wilderness during that generation. Now it's been set up in a village called Shiloh. And it's become kind of permanent there. It sounds like it talks about the doorpost of the temple, and it's kind of a permanent place there. And there is a priest and his sons who are involved. It doesn't tell us very much about how the Israelites worshiped God at that point, but some of them at least continued to go regularly to the tabernacle to worship God and to offer sacrifices. And it's during this time that a man is born. His name is Samuel. And Samuel is sort of the transition between these two times. He's kind of the last of the judges. He leads the people during some times of serious conflict. And he's kind of the first of the prophets leading into the monarchs. So Samuel is the one who anoints Saul and David, you know, as the first kings in Israel. He's this kind of transition person, very important in the Bible. And today we're going to be looking at not Samuel, but Samuel's mother, whose name was Hannah. And she's one of these really interesting people that we just had this sort of one chapter, you know, telling about her. But what an amazing story it is. So that's where we're going to begin now, in the first chapter of 1 Samuel, these two books that tell us about Samuel's life. So I'm going to start reading right at the beginning of that chapter. It says, there was a certain man from Ramathaim, a Zophite, from the hill country of Ephraim. Now remember, there are the 12 tribes. One of the tribes is Ephraim. So it's establishing Samuel's credentials, sort of, you know, talking about his father, where his father's from, what tribe he's from. He's from Ephraim. And his name was Elkanah, the son of Joaham, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zuph, the Ephraimite. So it's giving a little of his ancestry. By the way, you got to love these names. I know sometimes people want to have a biblical name, you know, when they have babies and they come up with, you know, John or Matthew or something. You seldom hear Tohu or Zuph. I don't know. They're just not so popular today. So here we've got this guy, Elkanah. In verse 2, it says he had two wives. One was called Hannah, and the other Penina. Penina had children, and here's sort of the key phrase of the whole thing, but Hannah had none. So here we've got this guy from the tribe of Ephraim. He has a wife, her name is Hannah, and she is barren. She has no children. It's hard for people today when couples want to have children and they're not able to. And, you know, medically we're able to do a lot of things that can help with a pregnancy, but often people are simply unable to have children. Some people choose not to have children. Some people wait later in life to have children. But in biblical times, especially at the time that we're talking about here, there was sort of only one reason, you know, for a woman's existence, and that was so that she could have children and particularly have a son. And to be barren, to have no son, to pass on the name, to pass on the land, you know, that was theirs as a part of that tribe, it was huge, huge disappointment. And for a woman, it must have just felt like, what am I worth, you know? And so Elkanah takes another wife, Penina. Now, the Bible doesn't condone or encourage men to have more than one wife. Polygamy is not taught at all in the Bible, but it's recognized that sometimes people did that. In this case, Elkanah's wife is not able to have children, and so he takes a second wife, Penina, and she has many sons and daughters. And she gloats over that. I mean, she must have seen that Elkanah and Hannah were, you know, in love. They were husband and wife. She comes in. She's sort of the second wife. Ah, but she has sons and daughters. And Hannah is cursed. She has none. I suppose that a lot of people thought about Hannah this way. She must be a bad person. She must have done something bad for God to curse her in that way. The feeling was when a bad thing happened to someone, it was because they were a bad person, because they were being punished by God. And so Hannah had to deal not only with being barren, but I would guess in indirect ways and in direct ways, Penina probably just rubbed that in her face, and she must be a pretty bad person for God to judge her and punish her in that way. Let's go on, verse 3 of this chapter. So year after year, this man went up from his town to worship and sacrifice to the Lord Almighty in Shiloh, where Hophni and Phinehas, the two sons of Eli, were priests to the Lord. Whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of the meat to his wife Penina and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah, he gave a double portion. That may also mean like the best portion, a double portion, because he loved her and the Lord had closed her womb. And because the Lord had closed Hannah's womb, her rival kept provoking her in order to irritate her. And this went on year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and would not eat. And her husband Elkanah would say to her, Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons? Poor Hannah. Poor Hannah. Not only does she not have children, but the understanding is that she's been cursed by God. And I think that attitude carries over into our world today as well. That we may not put it into words, but I think often when something bad happens to somebody, we think, yeah, I wonder what they did wrong. I wonder why they deserve that, right? And that was certainly common in Jesus' day as well. There's an incident in Luke chapter 13. Let me just read this to you. It says, now there were some present at that time, the time of Jesus, who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices. And Jesus answered, do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered in this way? And I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish. Or those 18 who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them. Do you think that they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will perish. Same thing happened a little later on. It's recorded in the 9th chapter of John. It says, as he, Jesus, went along, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Neither this man nor his parents sinned, said Jesus. But this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. So the understanding was, when something bad happened, it must mean that God is punishing, is cursing that person, and they must really deserve it. And I hear that question being asked today. This pandemic, you know, that's covering our world. Is God punishing the world? Is God angry at us? You know, are the people who are getting the COVID virus, are they bad people? Are God punishing them? And I think maybe that's a question that maybe some Christians have as well. Is that what we believe, that God is active in the world? Is that what's going on? I don't know that we have a total answer for that, but I think there's some biblical truths that can maybe help us to understand that. And the first one would be this, that all of us are sinful people. It's not that there are a whole lot of really good people, and then there are these bad people, and they're the ones that get cursed by God. The clear teaching of the Bible is that all of us are the bad people. All of us are sinful. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, right? Romans 3:23. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. We are all sinful people. And some people's sin, evil, seems more pronounced and maybe heavier than others, but all of us fall into that category. I think I've maybe shared, this is my favorite way to understand this, it involved my friend Jacob Pauli at Orchard Hill Church. So when I was a kid, we tried to, my friend Paul and I built this little high jump thing, and we tried to jump over, and I suppose we could jump, you know, 4 feet maybe or something like that. Jacob was a pole vaulter. And he could pole vault. His record was 19 feet, 1 inch. So if I were 6 feet, which I'm not, but it'd be three of me plus a little bit more, Jacob going up there. So it seems like there's a huge difference between the 19 feet and the 4 feet that Paul and I could jump or whatever it was, you know. But God sets the bar at 100 feet or a mile, you know, that according to God's standard, none of us even come close to getting over the bar, right? We are all sinful people. Psalm 130, verse 3 says, if you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? I mean, you understand that, don't you? You know, if God really did judge sin that way, you wouldn't be here today, and neither would I. We would not be able to stand in the judgment of God because we are all sinful people. Secondly, we see in the Bible that God does use tragedy and suffering to get our attention. Now, sometimes God punishes sin. Evil becomes so rampant that God needs to destroy it, to wipe it out. We've got Sodom and Gomorrah. We have Noah and the ark. But God can use any suffering, any tragedy, to get our attention. I had a pastor friend in the Minneapolis area, John Piper, if you're familiar with him. He wrote a sermon one time called Don't Waste Your Cancer. And I was really intrigued by the title. And so I got a copy of it and read it, and the point he's making is really good, and I think it's a point we need to remember as well, that any time tragedy or suffering come, it's an appropriate response for us to ask, God, what are you trying to teach me through this? So we can't say that every time anybody suffers or experiences tragedy, that there's a one-on-one connection, that God is using that to punish that person. That's a connection we cannot make. But we can say that in every tragedy, every bit of suffering, God is always there trying to teach us and to help us become more the people he wants us to be. So I think it's always appropriate when we're going through hard times, or maybe when we kind of get through them, you know, to say to God, God, why did you allow this in my life? What are you trying to teach me? How are you wanting to change me? How are you wanting me to be more like Jesus? Do I need more patience? Do I need more compassion for others? Do I need more boldness? How is it that you're wanting to mold my life and to use this circumstance, you know, to accomplish your will in me? Because God is always wanting to do this. God is always wanting to take us in that next step of forming our lives, of becoming more like Jesus. And so I think it's really a good thing for us to look at our nation and say we as a nation are suffering in many ways, you know. God, what are you trying to say to us? How are you wanting to change us as a people? How have we fallen away from your word and your teaching? How can you use this tragic time that we're going through to become more like Jesus? I think the church needs to ask that. During this time of pandemic, during this time of statewide suffering because of the recent storms, you know, God, how are you wanting to use this to help us to be more the body of Christ, to show your heart and your love and your compassion? So I think those are always appropriate questions for us to ask. Well, Hannah does something pretty important. She takes her problem to the Lord. Let's go on with this chapter, starting with verse 9. So once when they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, so Hannah and Peninnah and Elkanah have gone to Shiloh to worship, to offer sacrifice. When they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up. Now Eli, the priest, was sitting on his chair by the doorpost of the house. And in her deep anguish, Hannah prayed to the Lord, weeping bitterly. And she made a vow, saying, Lord Almighty, if you will look on your servant's misery and remember me, and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head. As she kept on praying to the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Now, Hannah was praying in her heart, and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. I'm going to stop there for just a minute. Here's a little Bible trivia for you. I read this one time, that in biblical times, it was like they had not invented silent prayer. Anytime anybody prayed, they always prayed out loud. And so here's Hannah, and she's praying, she's moving her lips, but the prayer is in her heart, not in her voice. So Eli thought she was drunk, and he said to her, how long are you going to stay drunk? Put away your wine. Not so, my Lord, Hannah replied. I'm a woman who is deeply troubled. I've not been drinking wine or beer. I was pouring out my soul to the Lord. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I've been praying here out of the great anguish and grief. And Eli answered, go in peace. May the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him. And she said, may your servant find favor in your eyes. And then she went her way and ate something, and her face was no longer downcast. Now, Hannah gives us a really good example here of how we ought to handle problems. When we're facing suffering and tragedy, and when we're dealing with problems in our lives, what should we do? You know, if you've got your list of things you could do, well, first I could try this, we could try this, this. Where does taking it to the Lord fall in your list? You know, down here somewhere? I've heard the expression, you know, when all else fails, try praying. Well, that's unwise, it's unbiblical, it's dangerous. You know, where should that fall? That's at the top of the list. When we have problems, when we're dealing with suffering, the number one, the first thing we should do is take it to the Lord. Hannah has this terrible burden in her life. And what does she do? She takes it to the Lord. And I love the last verse that I just read. So she's praying to God. She asked for a son. Eli, when he hears her problem, he blesses her and asks that God would give her the thing that she has asked. And then he notice what she says. Then she went her way and ate something, and her face was no longer downcast. Here she had been, this woman who's weeping and crying and pouring her out to God, and she takes it to the Lord, the problem to the Lord, and she leaves it there. She leaves it to God, and she goes away, and she eats, and her face is radiant again. That's a beautiful example for us. That's the kind of person I want to be. Because I find for myself, even when I've got a problem and I take it to God, I still sort of hang on to it. You know, I still kind of worry about it. I still sort of wonder, you know, if God is really going to come through for me. Hannah had this beautiful confidence. She has taken this to the Lord, and the Lord is going to take care of it. And sure enough, he does. And so Hannah goes home, and she conceives a son. She names him Samuel, which means God has heard me. And she begins to raise this child. And do you remember what the promise was that she made to God when she was praying? What did she say to God? If you will give me a son, I'll give him back to you. So we pick up the story in verse 24. It says this. So after he was weaned, she took the boy with her, young as he was, along with a 3-year-old bull, an ephah of flour, and a skin of wine, and brought them to the house of the Lord at Shiloh. And when the bull had been sacrificed, they brought the boy to Eli, and she said to him, pardon me, my Lord, but as surely as you live, I'm the woman who stood here beside you praying to the Lord. And I prayed for this child, and the Lord has granted me what I ask of him. So now I give him to the Lord. For his whole life he will be given over to the Lord. And he worshiped the Lord there. Goes on in talking about that. It says, you know, each year his mother made him a little robe and took it to him when she went up with her husband to offer the annual sacrifice. And Eli would bless Elkanah and his wife, saying, may the Lord give you children by this woman to take the place of the one that she prayed for and that she gave to the Lord. And then they would go home. What would you expect Hannah's response to be when God finally, after all this time, answers her prayer and gives her a son? One way she could have approached it is she could have held on to that boy so tightly. She would mother him and spoil him and keep him close to her all the time. He would be the most precious thing in her life. And I'm sure she felt that way. But what does she do with her son Samuel when he's been weaned? She takes him to the temple and she gives him back to the Lord. That's an almost unbelievable response on a part of a mother, isn't it? That she gave this long sought after precious son to the Lord. And I don't know if that resonates with you, but there's a part of me that just feels that really deeply, that some things are so precious, so important, that the very best thing we can do is to give them to God, to let go of them, to trust them to God. Reminds me of a story actually in 2 Samuel involving King David, who lived, when did he live? Yeah, I thought there's going to be a quiz on this later on. Yeah, about 1000 BC, that's right. So David and his men, Israel, he's king at this point, and they're fighting the Philistines, which they seemed always to be doing. So there's one point when they've had a battle during the day, and now the sides have gone back to their camps. And David is sitting with three of his, they call him mighty men of valor. I picture them sitting around the campfire, kind of talking about the day. And they're tired, it's been a rough day. And David says, this sounds crazy, but you know what? I would give anything for a drink of water from the well in Bethlehem, where he had grown up, his hometown, and that well with that cold, clear water. And then David says, well, we've got a big day tomorrow. I'm going to turn in now. And he goes into his tent to go to bed. And these three loyal companions of David look at each other and they say, should we do it? Should we go get him some water? And they decide they're going to do that. So all night they run to Bethlehem, and the Philistines are actually camped at Bethlehem, so they have to make their way through the enemy camp to the well at Bethlehem, and they lower that water skin down into that well, and they pull up that cold, clear water, and then they start the trek back to Israel's camp. And I picture David getting up in the morning, and he steps out of his tent, and he looks off in the distance, and he sees these guys coming. He realizes these are his three friends. And as they get closer, he sees they're dirty and tired. And what have they been doing? And they come up to David, and they kneel down before him, and they hold out this water skin. And David says, what is that? And they say, it's water from the well in Bethlehem. David realizes what these men have done, that they love him so much that they were willing to risk their lives to go and get him water from the well in Bethlehem. And that water represents to him something so precious, you know, the valor, the courage, the friendship of these men, their love for him, his love for them. He says, I can't drink it. This is too precious. Too precious. And he takes the water and he pours it out on the ground. I don't know how that strikes you, but it just moves me deeply. I want to be that kind of person who takes those things that are so valuable and precious and say, all I can do with them is give them to the Lord. That's what Hannah did with her son Samuel. She gave him back to the Lord, and he served the Lord there all the days of his life. And I am convinced that this great man Samuel, and when you read 1 and 2 Samuel, wow, what a powerful, godly man, used in amazing ways by God. I believe he was that kind of a man in part because he had that kind of a mother. So what do we learn from this? What do we learn from Hannah's example? Just let me mention two things quickly. First is that rather than being bitter, Hannah turned to the Lord with her need. She turned to the Lord. And secondly, that Eve, especially with those things that we value most, rather than being possessive and worrying and holding on to them, that we give them back to the God who gave them to us. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this beautiful story, just this short story about this woman who turned to you and trusted you, that you heard her prayer and that you would answer it. Rather than being bitter and angry, you know, she was able to go on with her life. And that she took her son and gave him back to you. And so I think lots of times we struggle when we worry about things rather than going to you. We try to solve the problems ourselves. We figure we can figure it out. We're capable, intelligent people. May we, you know, be like Hannah and come to you, to take to you our burdens, our problems, and realize that you hear our prayers even before we say them. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll continue our worship using the hymn Beneath the Cross of Jesus.
Jesus, I pray.
collecting an offering these days, but we do want to thank God that He's blessed us materially and allowed us to be a blessing to others. So let's remain standing, sing together the doxology, and ask for God's blessing upon what we have returned to Him.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Lord, we recognize that every resource is yours. The cattle on a thousand hills, the gold in every mine. You know, it's all yours. You don't need us. You don't need our giving. And yet you have blessed us in allowing us to have part in your kingdom's work through our giving, as well as through the way we live. So I thank you that you've provided for us, that we have homes in which we live and food to eat and cars to drive and all the things that we need for life. And that you've allowed us the privilege of giving back to you and believing that what we give, you take and you multiply and you use it in Jesus' name. We pray that you would use it to relieve suffering, to spread the news of Jesus Christ. Use it according to your will. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll remain standing for our closing hymn, which is Trust and Obey.
When we walk with Thank you.
And now as you go, know that the Lord our God goes with you. He goes before you to guide you and behind you to encourage you and beside you to befriend you and above you to watch over you. And then His Spirit goes within you to give you peace now and forevermore. Amen.